you're building a transnational democracy draft. So you have joined us for the session called Now is the Time for Transnational Democracy. And from the title, maybe you can guess that the goal of this session is actually not to discuss the pro and contrast of a global democracy or transnational democracy. I think everybody feels actually convinced that this is something we need. Our goal is more to rely to discuss all together on this panel and with you in this room how we can arrive at making global governance more democratic, how citizens can interact with the global policy making, and how we can take influence on global decision making as society and as people around the world. I think that after the past summer, where we've seen unprecedented droughts, all over the world, I think nobody can dispute that, that the crisis that we face today, some of them are really global in nature, and also truly in essence. And the climate crisis is just one example, but it's clear that it's something that can be solved by individual relationships, so it's something that we need to do together. It requires decisive global action and international coordination. And so in this panel, we will discuss how we can arrive at this kind of action with some very interesting speakers who are here with me today. So I will give them now in no particular order, and then I will give them to present themselves. Esther McCook, who is a citizen of the world and president of the Young World Federalist Global Movement working on transforming the system of global governance with democratic world federation. Stefan Kauder, president of Democracy of Global Switzerland, historian and political scientist who's currently researching democratic politics on the local level, Center for Democracy in Ottawa. And Lucy Kaufman, who's an expert on drugs and governance and accountability, and has helped become global, a group as well as a global community online democracy platform that believes that all human beings, regardless of nationality or citizenship, have the basic right to voice, a basic right and a voice in decisions that shape the world we share. Yeah, so thank you so much for joining us, and I would like to invite all of you to say a couple of quick words for yourself, the organizations you work for, and I'd also invite you all of you to share one provocative idea on how we can make transnational democracy in action. And so, let's start with you, Thank you.
Hello. Thank you so much. And we have to be a nice friend to join us. Typically, when I talk about these things, I'm a bit warmer, people disagree. But I see a lot of green stickers up on the front of us, believers in global democracy. So I'm really happy to see you, to be here. Yeah, as I said, I am the president of the Young World Federalist. My name is Esther McKay. The global movement and advocate to transform the system of global governance and to give humanity a voice in global decision making. We should take many pathways, but of course, at the end of the day, we're talking about like, reforming the United Nations and making it more democratic, as well as approaches to that idea. Yeah, so the provocative idea, a really nice talk that gave me a lot to think about in my very long span of life too. So I've actually just, well, first I'll say I kind of am wearing two hats. My colleague, Liam Guinness, is currently right now on another panel. And we both work for like a renewable energy NGO, specifically with the electric grid based grants. And so I was just in Brussels talking with some electric grid companies here in Europe that have projects that go between two European countries. And it was quite interesting because obviously the energy crisis for Europe is facing a capital conversation. So everybody was talking about the Russian invasion of Ukraine and so on. But what I learned is that the wealthy countries in Europe are right now backing up energy to secure the supply for winter. And so you have countries like Switzerland and Germany buying power from less wealthy countries in Europe. And I find that to be a little bit unfair because these decisions are made amongst a very limited, very small group of people. Electricity companies, ministries deciding these things. And in the end, that might mean that people who basically have no say in this decision are going to have blackouts this winter, while people who are lucky enough to live in wealthy countries won't. And so I believe that direct democracy, strong national democracy, partially being a crisis response tool, which goes against the prevailing narrative of crisis response, necessitates that decision making is concentrated as soon as people as possible to make decisions quickly. And I believe that deliberative and direct democracy, especially on a transnational level, should be a response to crisis. And this energy crisis is an opportunity for us to have transnational energy, deliberative democracy meetings that could happen right now to determine how we respond to energy crisis. And that would lay the foundation for, of course, a larger, multiple, overlapping crisis conversation.
Thank you very much. So, constructive approach, no worries, so good conscious story. Great. Stefan, how about you? How do you feel about yourself? And what do you work about with the conference and the
office? Yeah, thank you very much, first of all, for having me here and for the interest that you have in coming to this seminar or this workshop and this afternoon. As you already said, I'm working at the Center for Democracy Studies at the moment, and I'm the chair of Democracy Without Borders Switzerland. Democracy Without Borders is an international NGO working in different countries around the world. There are chapters, for example, in Switzerland, in the United Kingdom, in India, and Kenya, and we're trying to get some more. And the overall goal of Democracy Without Borders is to build a democratic world community based on a democratic constitution and the elected world parliament. And to achieve this goal, we think it's important to focus on three aspects that are global democracy, so that means that all major countries in the world should be democratic. Global citizenship, global citizenship education, that means that we need much support for democracy around the world in the population, in the citizens, and the third pillar would be global governance, which means that all nations or the major countries should be in favor of such an idea and should be willing to some competencies to this global level as well. And to work on this different areas, we have to say campaigns to work in for the Parliamentary Assembly of the United Nations as a first step to this world parliament. We work in the United Nations Citizens Initiative, and so direct democracy element on a global level. And as well, we are promoting and by civil society, and with all of this program, we want to achieve our overall goal. And we ask as well for the collective idea how to achieve that transnational democracy. And our interests are quite short and easy, and our understanding that we just need a directly elected world parliament with new competencies in the respective fields of power.
Thank you very much for that. Really, kind of the support that you have to have to the ideas that come from the industry, so it's not to work with becoming one of the persons you speak to. Yeah, and I think so to Lucy. Please tell us a little bit about yourself and share your idea of what you're going to do. Hello, everybody. I'm really delighted to be on this panel. I'm really delighted to be here for the tour and listen to so, Caroline, you asked us to pitch some provocative idea. But my idea, the idea of growth therapy, and very simply, is not provocative. On the contrary, as far as we're concerned, it's absolutely self-evident in the face of the shocking failure of national, regional, and international institutions to effectively address global poverty. Global's idea is also absolutely self-evident in the face of the dramatic disenfranchisement citizens across the globe to effectively participate in identifying and addressing pressing global issues. So, Michael's non-provocative idea is this. Every single person in this room, in this town, in this country, in this world, about 16 years old, regardless of their nationality, can vote directly on global issues. Imagine that. Every single person can have a say in how we solve global problems. We're not talking opinion polls and petitions. No, a direct vote on a specific issue and on specific solutions to the issue. We all know the context, right? Globalization has created a world of massively independent processes, for better and for worse. Some of these processes are really truly liberating and emancipating. If you think of access to knowledge, for instance, or the ease and speed of communication. Some of them are really threatening, such as the climate crisis and cyber criminality. And some are just still really unresolved, such as pollution, the global capitalism. Usually because powerful interests don't want them to be resolved. And many are just really complicated and messy and unclear in their outcome, isn't it? Such as, for instance, AI or big data. If left untouched, they may well have incredibly dire effects on individuals and whole societies, not to mention climate. But they can also be harnessed for incredibly beneficial uses in ways that prevent possibly eliminating. So these are all processes that are global in nature, and they're not just limited to one society or one nation. Rather, the causes more and more effects. And yet, global citizens, we have no say in how these issues are resolved. In other words, it's absolutely true that the citizens of this world are empowered in real ways to identify which global issues are pertinent, what global solutions are out there, and which of these global solutions we support and what we have in place. And that's why we created the Global Community. Our aim is to create a platform for global direct democracy. A platform which empowers global citizens by giving all of us the tools to engage in and shape effective decision making and global leadership. So, what are the key features of this platform? It would enable the collection and consolidation of issues put forward by global citizens, crystallizing the most pertinent global ones. It could enable the collection and consolidation of solutions, also put forward by global citizens, and identify those which are most appropriate. And it could enable the direct vote, and this is a mixing competition, the direct vote on these solutions, also by global citizens. This direct vote, of course, should be equipped with a unique and secure digital identity. So, we feel that global direct vote and global issues have immense instrumental as well as intrinsic value. The direct effect is that finally global citizens have an immediate say in global issues, cutting through the skewed and opaque political and economic It empowers citizens across the world who are presently disenfranchised and voiceless on a global level. The way these issues affect them and theirs directly. It also legitimizes solutions as they are based on the votes of citizens across the globe. This is a direct democratic legitimation of decisions that is completely absent in the global and it creates pressure on the local, national and international decision makers to take issues seriously, to be accountable in implementing the democratically produced and legitimized solutions. say, we don't want to replace existing institutions. We want to complement and strengthen existing institutions by giving ordinary citizens a seat at the global table. In fact, I would go so far as to say that with the help of digital tools, we want to co-create new global tables, new global spaces for interaction, debate, and decision making. So, our pitch is global direct democracy is the global answer to global peace. So thank you very much. We got now three very specific speculators, at least to sort of speculate imagination. I'd now like to take a step back, actually, and look at the very basic question, why do we need to approach democracy? And I think I'd like to start with asking to see what you think about that. And I just would like to point out the people in the room. But we also want to know what you think, and we would like this. So this is, we see this workshop as sort of a co-creator we want to end up with a statement on what people at the global forum think of transnational democracy and what we almost need. And so we're also collecting the answers on what that says. So if you could use this information, you can create a new So, I said, why do we need transnational democracy? Is it something that's important to the other one?
As you mentioned, what I was saying is, if you don't believe so, then please identify yourself. But these things already in place. I mean, there's so many, basically, issues that have been in the last 7 years have really become very globalized. And not only globalized, but transnational. So that right there is basically the short answer, is that as more and more things, more and more parts of human existence have become vast borders, especially when you think about economic things, like one global economy, increasingly with the internet, sort of a global society, but there is no global economy. And so that's sort of the element that's left out. And that, of course, comes from the very root why we have this kind of system, the nation state system. So a little bit different than global, I would say we need to somewhat replace the current system of nation states. I don't think it's adequate. For solving global challenges, it's very old. It comes from 1648, Australia. So it's a very old system. And a lot of things have changed in the world since 1648. So we need to transform the system of global governance and take it away, or basically encourage nation states to serve us. Very similar to what's happened here in Europe, but the EU super nationalism is what we are.
So I would pass that question on to you, Stefan, but I also know that you are also looking at local democracy right now. So I'd like to add to that sort of the, is there anything that we can scale up? Is there anything that we can learn from the local level
First of all, I maybe want to just add something to this answer. I'm afraid to begin to all what you said, but I want to emphasize another aspect where I think we need global democracy, not just because the problem is the global international, but as well just from a normative perspective, that we are living in the same planet, we are citizens of one community living together, and we need to have a system where we decide how we want to live together, how we want to share our resources. So we need to do it in one way or the other. I think that just from a normative perspective, democracy is the best answer to this question, how we live together in the same ground. And to your question about the learning from local democracy, I think there are a lot of learnings, and maybe the most important one is that if you're looking at the local level, municipality level in Switzerland, but all around the world, democracy looks very different everywhere. Within this continent, there are huge differences in how the municipality is structured and how democracy works. I think we just need to look at these different examples and get inspired by all of these different versions of democracy. I'm not saying that this democracy in that way is the right one, the other ones, the wrong ones, but to accept the differences and the all differences of different approaches.
I think that's a really great duality between this idea of democracy, the idea of the moment of idea of harmony and unfold. A short announcement one for translators are asking if anyone in the team actually needs German translation. Put this in my mind that you can go to the next one. Out of if you are comfortable with English, then I would say you can also take the book. It's on the German session, just in order to complete. Okay, so then I would move on to Lucerne. So also, of course, a very exciting question: why do we need transnational democracy? But I would also like to ask you specifically, because you are focusing on accountability in your work, is there a way that we can move towards transfer policies on the global? This is the easy one, and I think, yes, of course, we all have to take a stand on how we shape contemporary political systems which empower citizens in an account of difficulty and leads to the best possible outcomes. And I am really seriously concerned about the disenfranchisement in this environment of ordinary citizens across the world. I think we all need to be really creative and courageous in how we move forward. And we are really desperate of new ideas and actions. So, as far as I'm concerned, accountability and legitimacy is crucial to have in mind. Because I do believe citizens, individuals, and then of course scaling up into communities and the community actors, they are the key ingredient of any democracy. We are the people who make our world to save the world, and we have to think of new systems how we can do that.
I'd like to point out that there is a system of global governance that exists.
it's undemocratic, but it doesn't exist, and there's a lot of money back. And so the United Nations and other multilateral institutions support thousands of NGOs around the world that basically do the job of NGOs that are educating, they provide healthcare, they provide water and food, and the basic necessary goods to people around the world. And yet these NGOs, and I love them, and I think they're doing great work, and it needs to be done, but it's a stop there. There's a band-aid to the problems they have, and they're not accountable to really anybody. I mean, if they're out there grant proposals, they're accountable to the people that give them money, but oftentimes they're not accountable to the people that they're asking to save them. So there is no democracy in the system, and yet there is essentially a global government already providing a bunch of services to people around the world, and it's not accountable to anybody. So that's another value in the
system. I would like to end up from reading Mr. Stephen, because you mentioned that you're going to have an impact on the society, and that you're going to be free, and that you're going to be just coming up with a good idea. And so it's just going to be fine to do
there is too much of a failure of the legislative in order to solve this problem. But I think, it doesn't tend to be a prospect, but it's a question to, to reassure this accountability of the service stand by and influence in others.
So I think this brings us sort of in a natural way to the question of what is the role of businesses and what is the role of the existing multilateral system that we have. Right? So this is mentioned that in your starting speech, you don't have to replace the global government in place. But I think it's clear to all of us that we have to celebrate the 76th birthday in 2020, and it is this very big exercise where we interviewed over 1 million citizens around the world asking them to be representative of the countries. And other people said, this is a good group, we need them. And then they asked me, do you know what we have to help this too? Actually, I believe there's 3 out of 4 people there. But we know we entirely sure that this is this far from my daily life. So I think it's clear to everyone here and to the other people in the world at this point that the system needs change. But so what are ways that we can do that? What are some of the ideas that we have here to democratize the existing system?
I might just sound like a broken record here. Because I think, the direct vote of global citizens would really invigorate them. These are dynasties. Don't get me wrong, I think, leadership, historical achievements in the United Nations, for instance, at the end of the day, they really empower very interconnected and vastly power structures. Government and the United Nations, and we need that. People appointed by government, so it's 10 times removed from the United Citizens. So, and these are huge bureaucratic and insanely technocratic organizations. And so, everything in the parliament is in the organization. So, I do think that I know I'm familiar with the program, so I'm not saying that we completely have. But when it comes to new ideas, to really effective ideas, that are responsive to the needs and concerns of people around the world, I don't think they are what we need is a core field and private government. We need people to stand up, to feel empowered, and to have the tools to be empowered, to actually voice their concerns and also voice their solutions to them, and to create real communities, democratic communities. But you can see that across the world, we are all concerned about the tendency of democracy in this world, right? And so we need to think of new ways to invigorate the relevant field of democracy. And that's just us. And so that's why I really truly believe that everybody can do the absolute, and how many of you ever been to bed? I have no problem with that. But that's not a time to job. A time to job is to tap into the creative energy and intelligence of global citizens and dealing with them from critical and diversity.
I would love to hear from you, which is specifically what is the goal of the community.
can barely complete a term on my computer. But I'm glad to let the community benefit from technology. I think this idea of a global direct democracy, which we are supporting in terms of support, of course, is a term that So nowadays we have the tools to do globally, very easily, with very little obstacles. Of course, there is always the question who has access to the but in general, we are moving to a world where community people can do the kind of the technical things. So, in that sense, of course, an aspect which is much more technical and not the same thing about it is the identity issue related to immigration. So, of course, we all know after the US elections, etc., there is a real danger as well about that in terms of it can be abused, people can be influenced. So, these are real challenges that need to be addressed. But I think we have the intelligence to do that. And lastly, there are new technologies as well which would make it conceivable to have a direct democracy on a global level where you actually delegate votes to even with liquid democracy to get their technology which is used. So there are really interesting tools out there which you can use. So we are really at the very beginning. We've put our heads together to work in the organizations. We've also with the Global Democracy Initiative, where we're trying to create synergies with organizations having similar, not necessarily global democracy, but supporting global democracy. I've seen it from one of them. So we're very clear that this is a really major challenge that we have to do. And I think it will only the sort of dialogue and the culture of political debate we have it this year, we have it this morning, and we're opening up. And I think it will continue. If we don't talk to each other anymore, if we don't accept different opinions, if we don't have a culture, based on disagreement. That's what we need. We need critical things, right? And that's at a local level and a global level. So my hope is really that we can create these spaces and support people. We talked about democracy in Switzerland. People are not good. We can do it. In many parts of the world, there are global actions, but it is completely unbelievable. Even shaping the political decisions made on a national or regional or global level. So these are the kind of things that we really need to address with the digital means that we have now. That's a very interesting point, and maybe one thing to put in here. So is it possible to create a global sphere of political discussion? Can we most of that happen?
Global nature, and we really like to believe that we have sort of carbon access
global issues or national issues in this country, and that people from around the world debating the national issue. A lot of them are young people who are very critical of everything, including me and the organization.
So, Ben, is there anything you'd like to add to that? I'm also thinking that, I'm a bit frustrated here, that the campaign of the citizens of the state of the United States and in the geography of the mainstream and digital aspects.
Yeah, definitely. I think this is the new relationship since the beginning of the last two doubles for the democracy and means are debating to be good things for each other. But I don't want to repeat what you see already said, but I just learned on a very practical issue that I think is very important not to forget, especially if you're talking about how to speak English, the form of the language. And I think there the technology could be a huge advantage to bring people together who don't speak the same language, who don't speak English, so that they can have an exchange online on a platform somewhere and just speak local technology to the native language so that they really can express themselves as they want to, and that it don't just have that touching room for and be linked with able to speak English.
And I think this is actually, we have an example for that. As highly technological as it could be, probably, but of course, in the European Union, you have to be citizens of the state. You can gather signatures or you can hand them to the European Commission. And actually, your initiative, for example, is to allow language that will be used by the European Union. So, you have the service of reading this proposal in the European Union.
Yeah, the European Union is going to be a great example of how to manage all those different languages and use up all the things that we can use up at the conference and the future is all different and amazing the other language and just this way of language and it's just how we manage to do this and I still love it.
Yeah, there's a big interesting to your friends and you should be able to do that from the way to open this up. I want to ask one more question about the whole digital aspect of the democracy to the conference. I think in the last years, a lot of people have gotten more aware of the problems that the digital new democracy is going to be. So we have a group of leaders here today called How to Crack Our Algorithms. So how do we avoid our democracies landing in the hands of certain bodies, types of so we don't know where they got on the back. So this is I want to ask you how to crack our algorithms. I think the next workshop is much better equipped to do that. But are there any solutions that we have that you guys can think of?
I'm going to go to the next one. looking at the world of democracy,
these are the kind of questions we will be discussing both and we're still about to begin, it's in the and the challenge is I'm talking about the conspiracy theories, there are real risks and real dangers that we cannot be naive about that. And I think, I completely agree with what you're saying. I think that population mobilization size is a real striking real problem, and you can see that because it's so troubling. I think it's all right, you can see that when the government is at home. So, but then on the other hand, if you want to break that down and diversify it and create this pluralistic virtual space of decision making and algorithms, etc., you break it down and also you lose the critical mass. So, it is a real challenge. I can't see that we have the answers to that at the moment. Number one, number two, I think the nation state has completely they are really still in the country. And I think that's a real issue. For once, I think the European Union is doing good work there, but I do think that nation states really need to step up. The threats much more seriously, and then other actors can step in and they can do that thing, so not to do this. Some nation states that's been particularly skeptical about physical democracy is Switzerland. So is there other advantages of maybe this is possible?
I don't think it's much possible, but I see as well that each problem is facing that, and I think that this debate about people being collecting the source of the mistrust of people as well concerning such things, I think is very important to confirm that even though maybe the figures are safe, standing in there available and the kids actually do it technically, it's very important that the trust
Thank you very much. I would like to move to a little bit of research analysis. But I I'm only going to ask you two things. So I would like to hear from you what you think is the biggest challenge that you're facing in the past year of student policy and democracy, and especially if you're thinking about it, you don't know what the biggest opportunity is. So maybe if you start asking me for a question, you can ask me if you think
about it. Okay. The biggest challenge, who's worrying about the biggest challenge? That's a really difficult question. I think amongst our members and supporters, that these young people debating this big focus on sort of like the far right and the rise of fascism and sort of the mobile people that we're very afraid of. Some of the advocates for global governance reform were very close to the conspiracy theories around globalism and George Soros and Bernie Clinton. Sometimes that comes up in our members and that is what. But to me, that's honestly not really the biggest challenge today, but that's to me that's on the side. The biggest challenge is probably the people in the multilateral institutions who, yes, are doing great work. And I have a love-hate relationship with the UN and all of them, but the people that argue and push back against global democracy, and so first part of what's completely utopian and what will happen in our states and because the system that we have now works. And I think that ideology and that belief is probably the biggest challenge.
Thank you.
I would maybe go more or less the same direction, but I would say the biggest challenge at the moment are the democracy itself, because they don't want to get the competence, they don't want to build the democracy, and I can't really blame them for that, because they're built to don't do that. For a politician or for a government, it is not easy to promote this idea, but you won't win any election with this idea on the national state level, because elections in the national state level and on the government level. So I think the biggest challenge is really to get major democracies worldwide on board for such an idea, and that is really difficult because the system is still what it is.
Well, I can't argue with fellow panelists except the first of all the major challenges and many more beyond that. But I would actually say that the major challenge is that individuals and communities across the globe do not believe what they say. Right? They are not. They don't have that belief and probability instilled in them that they are actually the ones who can make the change. And we can even see that here in Switzerland, you know, where we've looked at the moment, the direct democracy. And so I think that is something, and I'm not just talking about direct democracy, all the tools that we've been talking about that. So I think that is a huge challenge to create a culture where people actually stand up and make progress and so to move to something a bit more hopeful, I would also like to hear from the
capitalizing on the challenge. There's opportunities everywhere. I feel like what I was saying with each of the people I really appreciate that. That's a really good result between those people not in Europe or in the States, other parts of the world that are inspired by these ideas. And they have their own connections and networks, and they're able to have their own NGOs and think tanks that they work with. Motivated, but then I'm not beating to the young people that really believe in me. I'm at the local level, speaking to people that participate in notable with the act of having local community and those who have the Yeah, just recently actually, so I started where people can find a lot of the apps. The map thing is that there's certain citizens and the most citizens of those that become the citizens of them. And surprisingly, all over the new program, surprisingly, all over the world, the question has been seen concerning myself as a world citizen with the highest percent of students in many and most of the countries. But I really take hope out of this that the people actually feel that they are world citizens, they want to be part of this community of world citizens, and they see maybe as well the necessity of global democracy. That gives me hope, and I think it's an opportunity that it can be achieved with the citizens supporting it.
Yeah, that's a really nice point, I think. And to, you know, for me, of course, it's actually, you know, digitalization, I do think, it's a huge opportunity that we have. And I hope, actually, in the forum and here in the forum, that we embrace that, that we really embrace that in forward-looking ways. And so, that is me. I feel very optimistic. Thank you very much for that. So I think just to close this session off with some more minutes and then I'm going to go on stage and I'm going to know about the material and I'm going to know this morning. I would like to pick up you today. So as I said, we intended this panel as a plea for transnational democracy. We want to come up with a sort of a public declaration. So if you go to this meeting, you can kind of write in and so you can really write in pieces of paper, that's your text. Of what are the elements that we need to build transnational democracy. So actually I would like for you to be able to do some of and what we need to put in place. And at the same time I would also like to ask our panelists that's my final question and to each of you. So what's the main thing that we need to work on now? So what is the main element that we need to have in place to make transnational democracy? I think we need to come up with that. But generally, I think we need to step out of the bubbles and have it to talk to. I think we need to collaborate much more seriously and intensively. And so, you know, a lot of criteria and thinking, one of the things in Europe, whereas actually, you know, we all need to get to work and be serious and not struggle where we feel like we're in a position. Many of those people are coming to the I'm seeing some really nice things in the stream behind you as well. both individual freedom to be more performing in the world, perseverance and doing, trust, whatever, I want to do something very practical to secure the ticket that I want to do, but I really like the middle of it. So to recognize our privileges and listen to the minds of others. And I think that's what I think that's maybe a key message that we can take away from the show and conversation with that and the people that are interested in the and so with that, I would like to close up this panel and enjoy the rest of the day.